Hey there, Kevin McLaughlin coming at you. I've got a bunch of awesome video from the 2018 Nebula Conference. Among them, there's an hour-long session where I filmed Data Guy doing a presentation on science fiction and fantasy marketing and the market in general. The overall look at it is things are pretty optimistic. Things are great in science fiction and fantasy. The session is very long. I'm going to post a cut down version of it at some point over the next few days once I get around to cutting it down. But this is the whole thing, and it is worth listening to if you have an hour to drop on it. Very full of information, great stuff, and something that any science fiction and fantasy writer should be paying attention to. All right, that's enough of the intro. Here's the show.
Data can be kind of boring, we'll try not to be. And so we're going to talk about science fiction and fantasy sales, adult science fiction and fantasy sales primarily. We're going to talk about the part that industry statistics can tell us about, and we're also going to talk about the part that industry statistics is effectively blind to. But before we do that, let's start with a little bit of a story. It may be a familiar one. Once upon a time, there were two genres, much beloved by readers, science fiction and fantasy. But after an all-too-brief golden age, it came to pass that the popularity of both waned. What we're seeing here is Nielsen BookScan publicly reported print units of science fiction. What we're seeing here is Nielsen BookScan's publicly reported science fiction and fantasy unit sales combined for adult science fiction and fantasy. And we can see that after 2009, things go off a cliff somewhat. And you can see, sad Keanu Reeves is not too happy about it. The Dwarven King. And so why did this happen? Well, the story goes that readers kind of outgrew these two genres. They moved on to more serious genres, whatever those might be. Or they moved away from reading altogether and got their science fiction and fantasy fix from movies, from Netflix, from video games. Or they're all playing on social media. So as a result of this, science fiction and fantasy sales fell. Bookstore SF&F sections shrank, and unfortunately so did SF&F author advances. So there still is an audience for science fiction and fantasy, but it's a more hardcore audience, much smaller than before. Science fiction and fantasy authors earn less than ever. Times are tough. So this is basically the story, and I'm sure you've all heard some variation of it through the course of the last decade or so, that industry statistics and publishing pros tell about our industry. And the good news for us is, it's completely wrong. So, let's go ahead and take the red pill now. Follow me down the rabbit hole of industry data, and let's find out why together. So it is true that after 2009, print sales in science fiction and fantasy fell hard, and they fell a lot harder than in most other genres. What we can see here in purple is the print sales reported by Nielsen BookScan for all genres combined, and the trend in those superimposed over the top of the trend in science fiction and fantasy. I've lined them up at the 2009 point. You might argue that that's a bit of an unfair comparison. I should have lined them up at maybe 2006. But it really doesn't change the difference in the two curves. What we see with print sales overall, including children's board books, scholarly nonfiction, poetry, basically all genres combined.
So the all curve includes the data in the red curve?
The all curve includes the data in the red curve. However, the scales are different.
Oh.
If you look on the right-hand side, you see the scale from the purple curve, and on the left-hand side. To put it into perspective, it looks like 26,000 or 25,000 is lined up with 750,000 million. So there's a factor of about 30 difference in overall scale between the two curves, but the patterns are interesting because we can see that they somewhat follow each other up until 2009 and then they diverge. And so print sales overall dropped until 2012 when they kind of turned around and started to recover, and they regained about half of what they had lost. Unfortunately, science fiction and fantasy did not recover. Print sales in science fiction and fantasy remained flat. And it's also true that those print sales in science fiction and fantasy have only stabilized because 40% of them are now happening online. And that's true of most other genres. The percentage varies from genre to genre. Here you can see in the purple, bookstore, Costco, Walmart, Books a Million, Barnes & Noble, the ABA reporting indie bookstores, and a projected amount for the non-ABA reporting are science fiction and fantasy print sales in purple. And then the orange is Amazon's science fiction and fantasy print sales. What's really striking about this is from the time we started tracking it in 2015, the rate of progression. So in 2015, roughly 30% were online sales of print, and that progressed to 35 and then 40 by the end of last year. Presumably this is going to level off at some point. One hopes. But for all of that, you know, which is a little bit of a bummer, as science fiction and fantasy enthusiasts, authors, participants, when we look at it, all of that is not that interesting compared to what's going on the digital side of the industry. So here we're going to take those pink print sales, and we're going to superimpose on top of that the ebook sales from traditional publishers only, and particularly from traditional publishers who report data to Nielsen PubTrack, now NPD PubTrack. And it changes the picture somewhat. Now, this might be a little bit confusing to a lot of folks who look at it and say, well, wait a minute, traditional publishers say that only 20%, 25% of their sales are ebooks. And that's absolutely true when you combine the aforementioned children's board books, scholarly nonfiction, poetry, the big James Comey, Donald Trump books of the year that sell vast numbers in print. Those tend to skew the equation in a particular direction. But when you're talking about narrative fiction, particularly genre fiction, and more specifically science fiction and fantasy, what we see is about 37% of traditionally published units are in fact ebooks for science fiction and fantasy. Let's also go ahead and add audio. There we go. So audiobooks are still a very small but rapidly growing section of the market. And what's fascinating about audiobooks is that science fiction and fantasy skews more towards audio than genres on average. What we're seeing is for traditionally published science fiction and fantasy, about 15% of units are now audio. And so when you look at this picture, it's a little different than that going off the cliff picture. In fact, the top of the slide's cut off, but it basically says that when you include ebooks and audio, traditional publishers are in fact selling more units of science fiction and fantasy than ever before. Okay, I don't know about the ever, because there was that 2012 peak, but basically more than in the pre-ebook era. But the question that may then immediately come to mind is which traditional publishers? Has there been some kind of wholesale shift from large brands to much smaller traditional publishers? So let's go ahead and break that down. This is science fiction and fantasy sales. Again, the top line is cut off there. From traditional publishing imprints, rank ordered from top to bottom. Now there's a little bit of necessary sleight of hand in here, because one can look at books that are ranked by BISAC code, industry standard BISAC code, but a lot of the books are put in multiple categories when they're listed in online retailers. So these numbers are based on retailer categorization. So a book could be listed simultaneously in alternate history, fantasy, and science fiction. And you'll see half of it appear in each of those categories, broken down this way. So it's deduplicated, but you know, there are books in there that won't necessarily be included as BISAC coded science fiction and fantasy. With that said, which is why the numbers are a little bit bigger than reflected on the previous charts, but once you kind of wrap your head around that, it's a necessary switch we need to make so that we can include non-traditional data, which largely we don't have BISAC codes for, but we know what browse categories they're listed in. So we look at the top imprint there for the last 12 months, a 12-month period ending basically 3 weeks ago. So this is the freshest data in the industry. We see Houghton Mifflin Harcourt on top, which kind of puzzled me until I dug a little bit deeper. And about half of that was Handmaid's Tale. The big takeaway here, folks, as authors and publishers, if you can get Netflix to run out for months on end, do it. It's worth it. Moving down, Tor, this shouldn't surprise anybody. Tor is the next highest selling, and Macmillan imprint, followed by Del Rey, Ace, and Berkeley, all Penguin Random House imprints. Orbit, Hachette, excellent imprint. Bantam, Open Road Media, an interesting entrant, the only non-Big Five or major old-school publisher on the list. Open Road Media, if you are familiar with them, is a fairly new entrant founded by an executive out of HarperCollins, and they brought a lot of classic backlist titles into a primarily digital sales footprint, and they appear to be doing quite well. Scribner, William Morrow from Simon & Schuster and HarperCollins, respectively, and then on down the list, Doc caught my eye at the bottom. As a kid, I used to bring home boxes of those thin yellow spine Daw paperbacks, you know, Jack Vance, all kinds of sci-fi authors I love, so it's great to see that they're still in the mix. However, question?
Does Bain fit into one of those groups somewhere?
They didn't make the list in terms of unit sales, but they would appear.
Okay.
If the list was longer.
Below the bottom of the slide.
So traditionally published science fiction and fantasy, however, is only half of the story nowadays, in a very literal sense. Because nowadays, traditional publishers aren't the only ones selling lots and lots of science fiction and fantasy. In fact, this is the breakdown of unit sales, and we're going to... This is the breakdown of science fiction. See, I told you. I have a very short attention span.
We'll keep it up for you.
Excellent. So this is the breakdown of science fiction and fantasy ebook unit sales. We have traditional publishers on the right-hand side in pink and purple and various shades of magenta. We've got non-traditional publishers, which we'll break that pie down slice by slice shortly, on the right. And what we see is, surprisingly, today in ebooks, traditional publishers now are the minority of sales. The vast majority are what we call non-traditional publishing. So let's break that pie apart a little more. We'll start with the traditionally published side. So we have the Big Five publishers. This is Penguin Random House, Hachette, HarperCollins, Simon & Schuster, and Macmillan, and their various imprints, accounting for 1 in 5 ebooks sold in science fiction and fantasy, so 21%. Next up, we have other large publishers, Houghton Mifflin Harcourt, Handmaid's Tale is in there, accounting for another 4%. Medium-sized publishers accounting for 2%, small publishers another 2%, and then micro-presses, traditionally published micro-presses. These could be very, very small specialty houses. Some of them are even indie authors who have basically opened up for submissions and pay royalties now to additional authors who want to publish under their brand, fall into the micro-presses category. This doesn't make a very good handheld. So next up,
you just lost your slides.
I think you bumped the cable.
The plug might have come undone.
Oh, I see what I did. There we go. So next up, we have Amazon Publishing Imprints with 7%. Now, Amazon Publishing Imprints are Thomas & Mercer, Skyscape, 47 North, Amazon Crossing, and I don't know if there is one that is specifically science fiction or specifically fantasy.
47 North.
47 North. So a lot of that slice is probably 47 North. But you'll also see Thomas & Mercer titles listed under multiple categories. An urban fantasy romance might be multiply listed. So those will fall into that category as well. In the big blue side, we have self-publishers. So 3% of all science fiction and fantasy ebook sales last year were self-publisher collectives. These are groups of self-publishers who share, perhaps, in addition to an imprint, perhaps share marketing duties, but each retains control over their own IP, over their own titles, branding, etc. A quarter of all science fiction and fantasy ebook sales are science fiction and fantasy self-published authors who have created an imprint name that is different from their own name. The other 24% there you see in blue is science fiction and fantasy authors who didn't really bother with a separate imprint name, but went ahead and published under their own name as publisher or put in no name whatsoever in the Kindle store for the KDP side, and then on the Apple and Barnes & Noble side typically put in just their own name. Finally, we have the uncategorized. So about 10,000 imprints were individually categorized for the colorful parts of the pie chart, and then the remainder were left in uncategorized because patience wore out and they were generally the lower selling ones, as you can see. So there's about 4% that are uncategorized single author imprints. What these are is basically self-publishers, but I didn't bother to go through and go name by name and verify that they were. There's the uncategorized few author publishers, which are a mix of micro presses, traditional micro presses, and self-published author collectives. In some cases, there are individual self-publishers with like six pen names that fall into that category. And then finally, uncategorized many author imprints, which are traditional publishers, which don't happen to be doing a lot in ebooks, but do have a lot of authors and a lot of titles. So that little tiny sliver of red, which you can barely see, I didn't bother to label specialty publishers. What's a specialty publisher? Well, for the purpose of this discussion, it's Wizards of the Coast. And we'll see when we get into the breakdowns of science fiction and fantasy, there are some subgenres where they are a very visible presence. All right, so why measure science fiction and fantasy market share in units, number of books sold? Isn't that skewing the balance a little bit in the favor of a certain perception? Why not measure it in terms of dollars? And the answer is, well, if we're talking about reader mind share, we're talking about fan base growth, we're talking about how many people have read and enjoyed and are passing on your book via word of mouth, reader mind share is really what matters to authors. However, we will look at dollars as well later, because that's what's interesting to the more professional side of the industry in terms of business. Nonetheless, does it really make sense to put both of these things on one pie chart? After all, traditionally published ebooks sell for higher prices, typically anywhere from $7 on up to $15, $16 in some cases. And aren't self-published ebooks selling for pennies? Well, let's answer that question. We're going to look at the breakdown by price. So here we're going to, for that same 12-month period, we're going to look at traditionally published ebooks first and how they break down in terms of unit sales by price point. And what we can see is the vast majority of sales are between $7 and $9. There is some activity down at $1.99 and $2.99. No surprise, that's promotional activity. That's book bubs and things of that nature. So there's a blip in units, but it pales in comparison to the large numbers of sales happening in that $7 to $9 price range. And there are some sales at higher price points as well. But the average purchase price last year of traditionally published science fiction and fantasy was $8. When we look at the non-traditional side, this is self-publishers, Amazon's imprints combined, what we see is an average purchase price of $3.20. The majority of purchases happening between $3 and $5, and some activity at 99 cents. When we look at the same chart in terms of dollar sales, however, for traditional publishers, that activity down at $2 and $3 isn't really a significant driver of direct income. It's promotional stuff. And similarly, when we look at self-publishers in dollar terms rather than in unit terms by price point, what we can see is 99 cents may move some units, but it doesn't put a lot of dollars in authors' pockets relative to the other price points. So what we can see is a traditionally published ebook at $8 on average is about 2.5 times the cost of a self-published or an Amazon imprint published ebook at an average of about $3. So it's not real price in pennies, which is a perception that often colors a view of our industry, and particularly in this genre. Here's another interesting thing, Kindle Unlimited. So a certain percentage of titles are exclusive to Amazon by author's choice as part of Kindle Unlimited's program. or I should say by author's choice, every 3 months, because you get to change your answer on the test every 3 months. And so we can see that Kindle Unlimited is driving about $30 million a year in direct-to-author revenue in science fiction and fantasy, and that makes up about 25% of author earnings, or I should rather say dollar sales of science fiction and fantasy. Obviously, those authors are giving up the ability to sell during that time period in the other ebook stores, but it is not an inconsiderable chunk of revenue. The other thing to note is we're industry professionals here, so we're slicing up the market in ways that make sense to us. Readers don't. Readers don't see these separate traditionally published and indie self-published and Amazon imprint published markets. What they see is one storefront where most of the science fiction and fantasy they are buying has an average price between $3 and $5. When you combine traditional and self-published, what you see is an average price for science fiction and fantasy sales last year of about $4.43. So I mentioned dollars. To readers and to authors who are trying to build their audience, market share means number of books sold, number of units sold, and read, preferably. But to publishers, market share means dollars. So let's take a look at that same breakdown, that same pie chart, by dollars. So here is for the last 12 months, May 2017 to April 2018, the dollar breakdown of sales in science fiction and fantasy ebooks. And by the way, this data comes from Amazon sales, Apple sales, and Barnes & Noble sales. There's a little bit of Kobo and Google that's missing, and a little bit from other places that's missing. Altogether, that adds up to a relatively small percentage of the market, though. Those three represent 95% of ebook sales in the US, so it's a pretty significant grouping of three. So what we see here is the big five publishers and their imprints with the higher price points represent 41% of dollar sales to consumers in science fiction and fantasy ebooks versus only 21% of units. So no surprise there, a much larger share of dollars. Similarly, other large publishers, we see 7% instead of, I think it was 4%. Those benefits don't trickle down in dollar form to the smaller size publishers because they tend to price more in line with Amazon imprints and self-publishers, more competitively with, I should say. Amazon's own imprints, their share shrinks from 7% to 5% of all consumer dollars. And there's a whole bunch of asterisks and caveats in there relating to things like Kindle First that we're not going to get into and tease apart right now, but ballpark, that's the number, 5%. Self-publishers, surprisingly, even at that $3 to $5 price range, are driving 40%. This is just verified self-publishers, are taking home 40% of the consumer dollars spent on science fiction and fantasy ebooks. And if you recall, science fiction and fantasy ebooks are a pretty big chunk of all ebook sales, period. So that's a whole lot of bacon. And then, of course, the uncategorized, roughly the same percentage as before, and in red, Wizards of the Coast. So something that we often hear is that self-publishers as a cohort, when you bring them all together and treat all their sales as one, do move a tremendous number of units. But that doesn't necessarily mean this is a viable way to publish as an individual. After all, each self-publisher could, on average, be doing quite poorly, but there are just so many of them that in combination their sales total to something highly significant. So let's find out if that's a reasonable hypothesis. This is the number of traditionally published and self-published and Amazon imprint published authors who have sold at least one SF&F, one unit of an SF&F title in the last 12 months in ebook form. And what we see is about 7,000 traditionally published, about 18,000 self-published, and 500 Amazon imprint published. So there's roughly 2.5 times as many self-publishers as traditionally published science fiction and fantasy authors, and they're selling roughly twice as many books. So not a tremendous difference in terms of the number of units on average. Let's also look at how they place in the charts. So So this is not a chart you're going to find anywhere else. What we've done is collate the individual sales of all of those authors and rank ordered them and looked at in the top 100 science fiction and fantasy dollar sellers in ebook form, how many were traditionally published, how many were self-published, and how many were Amazon imprint published. And aside from the really eye-popping fact that the top dollar seller in science fiction and fantasy ebooks out of all authors, including Ernest Cline and Brandon Sanderson, in ebook unit sales, there's one self-published author who outsells all of them. Now, when you look at the number of titles this author has in the market, it becomes less mind-blowing, but it's still a remarkable fact. So number one in the top 100 belongs to a self-published author. Other than that, and there are a few others in there, we can see that there are 31 self-published authors in the top 100 and 60 traditionally published authors, including all of the big names that, you know, we all grew up loving and knowing. Once you drop down into the top 500 and below, when we expand our lens, we can see about we're headed towards the 2-to-1 ratio that we would kind of expect if self-publishers and traditionally published authors were in general selling about equally well. And this is a very traditional bias slide in the sense that all the dollars that give you chart position in the purple in traditional publishing have to be shared with the publisher. All the dollar sales that account for chart positions on the self-published side pretty much go straight to the author. So there's a little bit of math in there that you have to do, which we didn't. We were lazy. It is worth noting, though, that when a publisher talks about market share, they're interested in overall dollar sales. Obviously, the share they get from the retailer versus, you know, what they can negotiate with one retailer versus another or under one pricing model, that determines a little bit how valuable those dollars are. I've gotten ahead of myself here, but for authors, it's royalty share. In fact, you know what, I'm gonna back it up because that's such a fun slide. Okay, so publishers care about dollar market share overall. Authors care about dollar royalty share. Hey, it's great that my book is priced at $17.99. What percent am I getting? How many of those dollars actually mean I can refinance my house? And so, here we go. So when we basically separate the portion that goes to the author from the portion that goes to the publisher, and this is based on a 25% royalty for the large, for the big five and for the largest of the publishers, and then 50% royalty to author for the micro presses and the small publishers, what we see is a very different picture. Remove the publisher share, and that's what the author is looking at in terms of take-home income. And that pie chart splits quite differently. Just look at the volume, if you will, on the blue side in author royalty dollars generated by self-published science fiction and fantasy versus on the purple side, traditionally published royalties generated by science fiction and fantasy sales. So this may sort of explain a little bit of that story that we keep hearing about science fiction and fantasy sales and how, well, once upon a time, but now they're fading and author incomes, times are tough. Two different worlds, some divergence happening, and you can see it very clearly in this picture, where all of the blue dollars are essentially going into self-published science fiction and fantasy author pockets, and all of the purple and magenta and pink dollars are going into traditionally published author pockets. So, a little dichotomy there. What's interesting also is to look at how things have trended in terms of what books are selling. Frontlist versus backlist versus deep backlist. So these are a term of art in the industry. In general, frontlist is the last 12 months worth of published releases. Recent backlist is the 2 years or 3 years prior to that. And then deep backlist is anything older. And so what we see is most traditionally published science fiction and fantasy that sold in the past 12 months by traditional publishers was in fact deep backlist titles. On reflection, this shouldn't really confuse anybody, because think of the fantastic backlists that traditional publishers have. The same books that we grew up loving and reading, and all those authors, many of whom are still active and writing, appear over there in the deep backlist section. Self-publishing, on the other hand, we can see that almost all of the sales on the non-traditional side are frontlist and recent backlist. And it's perhaps not surprising because there really is no deep backlist yet for self-publishing. So a very interesting question, if you look at the slide on the right, it sort of raises the question, what will happen 10 years from now as the non-traditionally published deep backlist has begun to fill in? Are we going to see the pattern match all the way down? You can see the traditionally published sales side looks like a scaled down version of the self-published side right up until about 2009, and then it goes up when the non-traditionally published side basically fades away because there were no deep backlist titles in the non-traditionally published catalog. When that fills in, will we see something that looks a little bit more like this speculative picture on the blue side? Don't know. It'll be interesting to see. Let's break down science fiction and fantasy sales by subgenre now. And this is something, because it's one thing to throw them all into one great big basket, but what applies to one subgenre of fantasy may not at all apply to a different subgenre of science fiction. So we'll do science fiction first. Here are unit sales by science fiction subgenre, again categorized by where the retailer puts it in the browse categories versus whatever device app code was assigned. I apologize for the small size of the font, but what we can see is the number one top selling science fiction subgenre is military sci-fi. Number two is sci-fi adventure. Number three is post-apocalyptic, and number four is dystopian. And number five is space opera. So what makes this more interesting is when we fade in what percentage of each subgenre comes from each type of publisher, or what percentage of the sales of each subgenre is self-published versus traditionally published versus Amazon imprint published. And so once we do that, we can see that in subgenres, traditional publishers own a lot more of the bar. In other subgenres, self-publishers own a lot more of the bar. And in fact, a clearer way to see this is to expand all the bars to 100%. And so you can see percentages across the top here from 10%, 20%, all the way up to 100% for each subgenre. The key is at the bottom. It's a little bit hard to read, but just remember, purple is big five. Various magentas and pinks are different sizes of traditional publisher. Green is Amazon's imprints, in this case, 47 North, for the most part, and Thomas and Mercer, et cetera. And then blue are the various categorizations of self-publisher. And so we can look at which genres are dominated by self-publishing to a disproportional degree. We see military sci-fi at the top of the list. The highest selling subgenre of science fiction is actually almost 90% self-published, only 10%. This might represent an opportunity for traditional publishers. I know half of the self-published folks in this audience are going, shut up. Alien invasion, genetic engineering, and galactic empire are also subgenres of science fiction where traditional publishers comprise a disproportionately small share of sales. And LGBT and colonization. So, on the other hand, these are the genres where self-publishers underperform compared to traditional publishers. We have dystopian, we have time travel, we have, oh, this one's a big surprise, classics. How about TV, movie, video game adaptations? Again, not terribly surprising to see self-publishing not well represented in that genre. And short stories. Short stories in science fiction are almost all traditionally published, we can see. In fact, there might be a tiny little sliver of blue in there, but if there is, yeah, it's dinky. And we can take a look at the same for fantasy. So So here are fantasy ebook unit sales for the last 12 months, broken down by subgenre. And what we can see is paranormal and urban by a mile. Paranormal and urban fantasy at about 11 million units, it looks like, or 11.5 million units, is the top-selling genre of fantasy. It's almost a factor of two greater than epic fantasy, which is the next. Epic fantasy is significantly larger at about 7 million units than swords and sorcery, followed by coming of age, and romantic fantasy rounds out the top five. Superimposing on this, the publisher type breakdown, we can see, again, the same pattern where some genres are strongly traditionally publishing dominated, others strongly self-publishing dominated. And so we'll go ahead and expand that out to 100% for each of those, keeping in mind at the top of the list you have the highest selling genres, and on our way to the bottom, progressively lower selling genres. I mentioned Wizards of the Coast. See the red? That's the Wizards of the Coast and their ebook entries. Dragons and mythical creatures, again, nothing surprising here. Action, adventure, TV, movie, video game adaptations, and a little bit of epic and sword and sorcery are all places where Wizards of the Coast plays. Beyond that, we can bring in the fantasy subgenres where traditional publishers underperform on a relative basis. And so we have the top one, paranormal and urban, where they make up about 20% of unit sales, and coming of age, where they make up about 10%, new adult and college, superhero and myths and legends, metaphysics and visionary, and Christian fantasy, which is again down near the bottom of the list, a relatively small genre, but one that is almost entirely self-publishing dominated. On the other hand, historical fantasy, self-publishers underperform on a relative basis. They also underperform in action adventure, TV, movie, and video game adaptations, no surprise there, classics. And in a turnaround from science fiction, military fantasy is an area where self-publishers underperform relative to traditional publishers, as well as humorous and alternate history. So I know there's so much here in terms of data density. Rest assured, we're going to figure out a way to make this available to everybody.
And the flip side of it is where you're not boxing a category, everybody's performing at about their market share. Is that right?
By definition, yes. Absolutely. Of course, we can over-focus as industry professionals on what this means for publishers, for authors, for agents, when in fact we all owe our livelihood to readers.
So I had a question on the previous one. When you grab romantic fantasy, is that only where fantasy is the primary category, as opposed to like when it's romance and then fantasy subgenre?
So what we actually end up doing is we take things that are multiply lit. We take things that are listed in multiple categories, and we play partial credit games. So something that is listed in, and there are some books out there that are listed in five different primary categories, we put 20% of the units of each, of that book into each category. So something that is romance and urban fantasy will get half credit.
Okay.
So it's a little bit of mechanics, but it allows us not to duplicate so that we're not double reporting, basically. And it also makes it a lot easier for us to combine data that's browse category based with industry BISAC code based data. So readers are the main drivers here. And so let's look at what happens when we add all these non-traditional ebook sales to the picture painted of traditional ebook sales and traditional print sales and traditional audio sales by industry statistics. And I don't know, that gives me the warm fuzzies. That's readers. That's readers reading science fiction and fantasy. It's almost exactly the opposite of the picture we get of bookstores shrinking their SF&F sections even relative to the rest of the books they sell. The fact is, science fiction and fantasy is a genre like romance that has gone digital, very fast. And when you count all of the digital sales that are really happening, we see it looks like science fiction and fantasy sales have basically doubled since 2006. Which begs some interesting questions. Who are these readers? Are these new readers? Folks who didn't read science fiction and fantasy before, but now do? Or are they the same old readers who can now read twice as much as they used to? Are these folks who used to, like me, go to garage sales and sort of bring in, I triggered it, go to garage sales and bring in boxes of those Daw Yellow Spine paperbacks? Or are they library readers? We don't know. The data really doesn't tell us. So all it tells us is that science fiction and fantasy readership has basically doubled. And it's being underreported by a factor of two in industry statistics, leading to a very distorted picture. In other words, it's telling us that science fiction and fantasy readers love SF&F more than twice as much as the industry thinks they do. But then again, that's good news. If you're in this room, I probably don't have to tell you that. You know it. Anyway, thank you very much. That's what I have. We can do questions. Questions?
How do you classify small, medium publishers? You said that by unit sales in the beginning. What are those unit sales that you would...
So it was relatively approximate. It was a mix of unit sales in ebooks, how prominent a name they are. So even if they don't really sell a lot of ebook units, but they have a large footprint in print, we went ahead and included them in with the larger category. And so I don't off the top of my head remember exactly where the cutoffs were. It was largely, we were looking at a list of 10,000. And on the traditionally published side, I think there was about 2,000 or 3,000. And we were kind of going, have I heard of them? What are their sales? Oh, they're an imprint of this publisher. They go in Big Five. Have I heard of them? What are their sales? Oh yeah, they're medium. And so the short answer is a little bit of hand waviness went into exactly which of the colored wedges they fell into, but in the aggregate, because we were looking at each one and verifying that they were a traditional publisher of some scope, size, or scale, they're not gonna be off by more than one category. The Big Five, we had it very easy because we know their imprints. So those are very complete. And then the others, there's a little bit of fuzziness about whether they consider themselves medium versus we consider them medium, et cetera.
Do you know just even a rough guesstimate?
So I think $10 million a year dollars would put you in the small, and about 40 or 50 was where medium transitioned into large. So let's see if I can actually project this, and I probably won't be able to, so I'll just wave my hands at it. Starting in May of last year, April actually, sort of mid-April, we began scraping Amazon, Apple. We began scraping Amazon, Apple, and Barnes & Noble at an industrial scale, basically starting from the top of each of their bestseller lists, going through all the also bots, pulling about 1 million titles a day and recording the sales ranks of each of those titles on each of these stores. And then we also calibrated that against known sales data on initially hundreds and later thousands and tens of thousands of titles to get an approximate range. And it isn't just correlating a single day's sales rank to a sales figure. It's looking at the history of sales ranks and whether there's a spike or whether it's a steady seller. And so basically using that to map sales ranks and the evolution of sales ranks of the book to unit sales. So accuracy-wise, when we compare against a large basket of known good sales data, we're within 10 to 15% in general. Now obviously, if you get down to how much did this specific title sell on Tuesday versus Wednesday, we can be off by about 50%. But over a longer time period or a larger number of titles, that error collapses to about within 10%.
Who is this we of which you speak?
Excellent question. So there's a commercial venture associated with what I do called Bookstat. It's currently a pub- publisher and industry scale targeted product. Down the road, our hope is to find a way to bring some of that visibility to authors as well, but we haven't found a business model yet that works for that. So think of it as a competitor or complement to Nielsen BookScan, basically.
So imagine I'm a writer that I've been through this whole period, and I was traditionally published, and now, you know, and things have taken off for me. Financially, am I any better off, though?
Now that's
can I pay the bills?
That's a very interesting question, because on an individual basis, the answer could be anything from amazingly to no.
Right.
In the aggregate, authors are better off. I mean, I think we saw that with the big blue side of the author income.
Now that's percentage of sales. That isn't how much, factoring in the price, factoring, you know, that when I get all done with this, am I getting my money's worth?
As an individual, I can't answer that question.
Well, I meant in general.
In the aggregate, in general, absolutely. There are more dollars flowing to authors in general and to science fiction and fantasy authors in very specific terms than ever before. And some of that comes at the expense of publishers, in the sense that the split on average has shifted a bit more in the author's favor. But publishers aren't hurting either. In fact, they found a lot of success in navigating the digital change. The meme about publishers not knowing what they're doing and being blind, you know, it sounds good. It's a story. It has very little to do with the reality that we're exposed to daily when we interact with big five publishers and smaller and medium publishers. There are some very, very savvy people who have figured out how to navigate that change.
So that actually leads into my question, which is, you mentioned that you market your services to the industry. Are the big publishers interested in this data in terms of doing better with what they're doing, or are they interested in trying to capture more of the other stuff?
I'm not sure how those are different.
Okay.
You know, I mean, if you're a publisher, you want to grow your share of the pie, and you want to grow the pie to grow the share of dollars within each chunk of the pie. And you have a much more complicated formula or equation to balance than an individual author does looking at just their own titles, because an individual author can basically prioritize their own titles 100% all the time. They can prioritize the format that's making them the most money that day or that week, whereas a publisher is balancing a portfolio of anywhere from hundreds to hundreds of thousands of titles and figuring that if they overemphasize this batch, they're going to underperform here. If they overemphasize digital, they're going to hasten pushing print sales in a direction where the prices become untenable because print runs shrink. So they're balancing a much more complex equation. With that said, whether it's capture or whether it's growth, it's more dollars. And so that's what they're after, as all of us are in terms of this industry. More readers and more dollars.
I'm interested in how you capture the Kindle Unlimited sales. As an author, my sales versus page reads, 2/3 of my revenue comes from page reads.
So that varies a lot by individual author. It varies by genre. It varies actually by book, because sometimes you'll see something crazy like Franklin Covey's 7 Habits of Highly Effective People was a splash screen on Kindle for a while. So it racked up a huge number of Kindle Unlimited downloads, the vast majority of which did not convert to reads.
Uh-huh.
And so there is a factor in there called the ghost borrow factor. And on an individual book, it can range from, you know, zero, like everyone downloads your book, no one reads it, to something that's up in the 70% or 80% range for books that are not just random pickups, but that are largely getting read because someone's read the previous entries in the series, etc. And so we have the average, which is about 54%. And so what we're doing in our data is applying that average across all titles that are in Kindle Unlimited and saying 46% are sales, 54% are downloads, and then we subtract the ghost borrow factor from those. And the ghost borrow factor is 26% on average just don't get read. And so what we're doing then is being correct on average and wrong on every single title that's in KU except in the event of a serious coincidence.
within either the Indian community or the traditionally published community. Based on what I'm asking, so in traditional publishing, often it's a handful of major brands that are doing the lion's share of the sales. Like we saw how much Handmaid's Tale skewed the numbers. Do you see a similar effect on the indie side?
We do all the way up to, so it's all power law.
Yeah.
It's all power law, both on the indie side and the traditionally published side. We would love to see a world where income gets equitably distributed among all authors. Neither model results in that, and I think there's a lot of economic reasons they wouldn't. What we do see on the traditional published side is the very tip of the head goes much higher relative to the shoulder of the curve, if you will. You know, the mid-list on the indie side is maybe a little bit more robust than on the traditional publishing side, but in general, both are the same power law.
The basic shape looks very similar. Okay.
Almost identical. If you log plot the distribution of author incomes, you end up with almost straight lines that actually bend down a little bit as you get deeper into the tail. And the traditionally published one bends up a bit at the tip, if that makes sense.
For someone who has yet to delve into either of these pools, how should I be thinking as I go forward?
That's a difficult question for me to answer, because the answer depends on what subgenre you write, what connections you have with readers in terms of a platform, how willing you are to sort of roll up your sleeves and dig into marketing and advertising, learning about Facebook ads, AMS. You know, some authors, they're hungry for it. They just want to learn that stuff. Others go, this is a distraction. I know I need to do it, but every minute I'm doing it means I'm not writing. And so what we did see is some subgenres are highly traditionally publishing dominated. Let's find out why. Dig into it at the title level, perhaps. Go to the bestseller charts on Amazon and Apple and iBooks and go, oh, well, it's all Handmaid's Tale. Or it's all, a few years ago, it was Veronica Roth, right? Once you take that piece out of the equation, how does the mix of authors on those bestseller lists divide between self-published and traditionally published? Are the ones that are self-published on that list popping on for like a day because they're at 99 cents and then falling off again? Or are they holding steady at $4.99, $5.99? You know, so I wish I had a more specific prescriptive answer, but that's the journey we all face as authors. And the only thing I would say is don't make self-limiting decisions in the sense that you go, well, I have to be on submission, so I can't even explore other possibilities for the next year and a half with this title. Or vice versa, I'm not going to look at traditional publishing as a route. I'm not going to show any agent this manuscript because I'm going to self-publish it. Because either of those is kind of foreclosing the possibilities along the other route. And you know, maybe it means some uncomfortable conversations where you go, look, I'm going to give you this on submission, but don't think I'm going to just let you sit on it for 2 years. You know, I need to hear something within 6 months, or I'm going to pursue other options with it. And if that doesn't work, you're not the agent for me. Yeah, so I don't know if that's helpful.
No,
but
I saw you talk at RWA about the series data. You didn't get that for sci-fi fantasy?
I didn't. There was...
God damn
so
it!
Much this really is a rabbit hole. I mean, every time I do one of these, I have to cut it off at some point and go, now it's time to make a PowerPoint, right? And I'm always frustrated because that's the point where I finally know the really good questions to dig into.
Why the discrepancy in average price, I assume a mean price, between traditionally published ebooks and indie ebooks? Is one side or the other leaving money on the table there for some reason?
Wow, that's a good question. And I think the answer is no. And the reason I think the answer is no is, I think the reason the answer is no is that, who was it? Was it Delilah Margo used bacteria as an example for indie authors? And it's a little gross, but bear with me. Bacteria evolve extremely fast. And there are so many of them that if an entire colony dies out, as long as one or two survive, the lessons learned get passed to a whole batch of new ones. And so indie publishing as an entity, rather than individual indie authors, have evolved great efficiency.
if there's a benefit to raising your price or lowering it on average, it essentially happens. It may not happen for every author, but the authors who are priced right tend to bubble to the top, or priced right and writing the right length, etc. On the traditional publishing side, like I said, the equation's a lot more complicated. They're balancing more things than just raw dollar output for ebook editions. And so they have found, with a fair amount of success here, a combination that works for them, that lets them take advantage of the opportunities that are in the digital market without completely leaving behind what is a core competency and something that they can do that essentially nobody else can at scale or efficiently. So I don't think that if indies all suddenly raised their prices $2, they would see benefit. And similarly, I don't think that, in fact, traditional publishers have experimented a little bit. In fact, without getting too far into the weeds here, what they've done is some very unsuccessful acquisitions and a few successful ones, where they let the things that make a imprint that was formerly an independent publisher successful continue. For example, global rights. There are very few within traditional publishers, big publishers, very few divisions that were acquired that have global rights to books. And so they use the same cover, they market it at the same time, they release it internationally, and they have a footprint of sales that's 50% US, 50% outside, even if they're a UK branch or a Canadian branch. And then I think that's probably the most successful model for adopting lower prices that the big traditional publishers have had, because they cannot just lower the prices on their catalogs. That would be financially a misstep. I'm not sure if that helps or answers the question. Oh, we're over time? All right, well.
No, you got one more.
You got, that was the 5 minute bring out your dad.
That's what it was. So there's a question? I'm sorry, go ahead. Certainly. So in certain markets, and please correct me if I go off and don't paraphrase correctly, but in certain markets we've seen smaller traditional publishers and imprints under price pressure from indies find that their sales are negatively affected and even had to close their businesses down. And so is that something that we should anticipate being a broader trend or a larger scale trend? I think I was a bit glib when I talked about traditional publishers navigating the change, because the ones that have navigated it the most successfully are the largest traditional publishers and the ones that are agile and digital savvy and are able to do things that most indies can't, even with a largely digital footprint. A great example of this, Bookature, fantastic folks. These guys have managed to basically be both dynamic and priced aggressively and have a global rights management footprint and also take advantage of the scale and possibilities offered by being part of a big five publisher. The ones that are not going to do well, the imprints that are not doing well and aren't going to do well, are the ones that don't have a lot to offer authors beyond what authors can do for themselves in a self-published world. And those are the imprints that we've seen largely get devastated by self-publishing and be a more viable approach. So does that help or answer the question? Short answer, yes. I think a lot of those imprints are in trouble unless they figure out a way to up their game in a way that self-publishing can't.
Thank
you. You know enough about the audiobook market? Does it follow the same as ebooks where Amazon, Audible, Apple are X% of the market?
It's worse.
Okay.
So it's worse for a number of reasons. The first reason is, of course, Audible is a division of Amazon. And let me be more specific. It's worse in the sense that it is more concentrated. My implicit bias here is that having a large ecosystem of retailers, of publishers, of self-publishing options benefits readers, benefits writers, benefits everybody. And so when I say worse, I mean more concentrated. So Audible not only is a huge percentage of the market in and of itself, it's also the, or up until very recently, was the exclusive distributor for iTunes. So all of the ebooks that you're getting, or audiobooks that you're getting through iTunes, were essentially Audible. And, you know, I hesitate to put a percentage on it, but I say that and then I do. It's 85% or so, 85 to 90%. Further complicating it is the fact that Audible Studios, as a publishing arm of Audible, is responsible for a big, fat, wonky wedge of all audiobook sales. Them and Brilliance, also an Amazon property now. So a lot of traditionally published ebooks go through, the audio rights are sold to Audible Studios or Brilliance. A lot of indie ebooks, the audiobooks rights are sold to Audible and Brilliance. So when you look at the share of the audiobook market, that is Amazon in one way or another, even ignoring distribution, it's like 25%, 30%. And that's just the ones they publish. They distribute essentially all of it. AuthorEarnings.com has a lot of, and some of them are frankly dated now because the site's been live for about 4 years, but the most up-to-date explanation of what the methodology used to be is available on AuthorEarnings.com. Since then, it's become proprietary, but it's really quite similar. Just more math, more computers, same approach.
If you watched all of that, you are awesome. I hope you got a lot of value from the broadcast. This was some good stuff. There was a lot of meat in this and a lot of takeaway lessons. There's some markets out there that are not heavily indie yet. Let's look into that. All right, that's it for today. Thank you very much for being with me, and have a good day with your writing.